Good evening from Appleton Arena, the campus of St. Lawrence University. It's Skating Saints Hockey. And tonight, the Saints begin the season, the 25th in the remarkable coaching career of Saints head coach Joe Marsh.
St. Lawrence is able to attract top-tier student-athletes to the university for a number of reasons. We have first-rate facilities. Our arena is one of the best in college hockey. We have a beautiful campus with a real strong sense of community. We're one of the top liberal arts schools in the country. We have new facilities here for our players. The future of the men's hockey program, I think, is extremely bright. There's a lot of positive energy right now. Combine that with the fact that St. Lawrence's reputation the last couple years has really taken off. I think it's very attractive to kids who want to come here and develop into professional hockey players, while at the same time being part of a real family. Coaching staff is tremendous. We have a ton of experience at the NHL level, the college level, former All-Americans. We really feel that kids who want to develop into being stronger professional hockey players, we have all the resources to help them get there.
St. Lawrence University was founded in 1856. Almost 70 years later, in 1925, the school found a new institution.
We are on the map in many ways because of hockey. If you're traveling in the Northeast or the Midwest or now the West Coast, people know St. Lawrence largely because of this great tradition.
The program is 75 years old, and this has been a tribute to the university to have a coach like Joe Marsh be part of a quarter of the history of the program. He has matched the mission. He makes the program fit into the natural culture that St. Lawrence wishes to provide student athletes.
The culture at St. Lawrence is symbolized by the game of hockey. The fabric of the university is as intertwined with the sport as any in the country. It's a family affair, just as it's always been for Joe Marsh.
I was influenced so much by my older brother. My brother John's 10 years older than I am, and he was an outstanding player at Boston College, went on and played in the United States national team.
Johnny Marsh and I were contemporaries, and we established a long friendship playing in the summer down at the Lynn Arena in Massachusetts, and Joe was tagging along all the time.
He got me going down to the rink on Saturday mornings. I think I played it because I wanted to be like him, you know, but then eventually I got the bug.
You could tell then by the way he played and the way he studied the game that he was going to have a bright future, both as a player and as a coach.
Certainly the influence my brother had on me was the greatest influence to stay with it.
Being influenced by an older brother is ordinary. Being the greatest influence in the history of St. Lawrence hockey is quite the opposite.
But F1 and F2 have got to be coming hard, and you got to be coming hard off the back check.
Looking back, there is only one word to describe Joe Marsh's career.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
St. Lawrence has a tremendous tradition being in ECAC hockey for 50 plus years. But certainly Coach Marsh has taken the St. Lawrence program to some great heights.
The program was really sort of floundering. It was okay, but it wasn't great. And he brought really good hockey back to St. Lawrence and maintained that level for years and years.
The year it all started was 1983.
Mike McShane came in the early 80s and really set the tone and changed the culture of the program and brought Joe in and gave Joe a great opportunity.
Mike called me, there was an opening that developed early fall in 83 and said, you know, would you be interested in this? And I came up here and I absolutely fell in love with Appleton. Mike offered me the job, and for 2 years I was Mike's assistant. Mike went on, took the Providence job a couple of years later, and I was fortunate enough to be at the right place at the right time and was able to get the St. Lawrence head job. Certainly don't regret it for a second.
You know, the 70s and 80s were okay, but when he got here and started as an assistant coach and then when he moved up to head coach, the level of the hockey just really improved substantially. I do believe that the hockey program, in terms of its success, is in large part due to Joe Marsh.
Let's make sure we get good support, and I think we're better off getting it down low if we can, all right? But we need support for the D. They're trying to hem right up, all right? Let's go. Come on now. Get that thing moving fast.
Joe Marsh's career got off to a slow start, and moving fast took on another meaning.
Joe, his first year as our head coach, he started off 0-7. And I was at the seventh loss, and that was at Clarkson. It wasn't a good night, and so we went back to the good old Journey's End for a couple beers, and everybody's lamenting the fact that we're 0-7, and how long is Joe Marsh going to last?
What's he doing over here? That f***ing kid, get him out of here!
But I also look back, number one, these guys did a great job recruiting.
Joe took the bull by the horns. He was fortunate enough to have that first class that he really recruited in here. So they knew Joe really well and his passion. And in that era, those type of kids really excelled under Joe and here at the university.
That kind of set the stage for what they did in the late 80s. And that was obviously going to the NCAA title game against Lake Superior State.
Well, the 88 team, Randy Sexton and I, when we were the assistants, recruited the bulk of that team. You know, Pete McGeo and Hank Lammons, the Lappin brothers, Jamie Baker. You get down the list, a pretty impressive group. The next thing you know, we had a championship caliber team. One overtime goal away from winning the whole thing.
Beating Minnesota in the semifinals at Lake Placid, which was one of the highlights that I remember of St. Lawrence University hockey. I was there at Lake Placid. It was absolutely incredible.
To this day, probably the best team I've ever been on at one level. We lost 9 games that year all by one goal, and yeah, we didn't win the national championship game, but boy, we were a great team, and it started with the coach.
Certainly you laid the groundwork for a lot of good solid years to come and really set the culture on its course to what we wanted to really develop and try to build a tradition. It was a great tradition, I think, in St. Lawrence hockey that goes way back, but you know, tradition is not something you really can rely on. It's something you have to build on.
And build on it they did. During his 26 years at the helm, Coach Marsh led the program to unprecedented heights, winning over 450 games and creating a legacy as impressive as it is long.
Most career victories, 4-time ECAC Coach of the Year, 2-time NCAA Coach of the Year, a number of NHL players. But I think Joe's equally as proud of the great young men that he's mentored over his career and all of the great things they've done. Joe's legacy is far-reaching, well beyond the borders of St. Lawrence University and the college hockey community. Simply put, he's one of the best college coaches to have ever coached the game.
A great coach, his teams, he's had great success, winning tradition, and there were always teams that were very, very difficult to play against, and we didn't have that much success against them because they outworked us, and his teams usually did outwork most of their opponents.
Well, to me, Joe will always be the face of St. Lawrence hockey. He built this program doing things the right way, the fundamental values that I think college hockey should be proud of.
He's brought a lot to the game. The way that his teams played, they played hard, they played tough, but he was one of the most respected coaches in the profession. He was a great role model for not only older coaches, but especially for the younger coaches.
Young coaches can look to Joe and, hey, that's a great standard. He worked extremely hard, recruited athletes that were very representative of St. Lawrence University, and always had very, very competitive teams.
And Joe, there's always been two bottom lines. Of course, there's the hockey season, the one lost record, which everybody loves to follow and celebrate. But also commencement day is the most important championship for Joe Marsh.
He develops people first, students second, and then hockey players, always has. He's always looked at a bigger picture. What can you not like about a coach that looks at you and treats you with that kind of respect?
He's achieved a lot, coach of the year, individual accolades, but I know that's never been his goal. His impact is in teaching young men. They're successful on the ice, that is clear based upon his record, but off the ice just as much so, or more so.
He created an incredible amount of balance. He had a great perspective on what was important at certain times. Obviously, when it was time for the puck to drop, it was hockey. But once it was over, it was over. We had great success that way. I wouldn't say it was a hockey factory, but we produced some pretty good hockey teams under Joe.
I mean, there's some programs out there that have had more success in the rink, but I don't know if all the players that have left have been as successful in the real world. And that's a credit to what Joe does.
If you don't have any gas left, just get your feet moving. Move off the wall if you have to. Use the glass boards, but it's gotta be stronger than that, all right? Behind you, Ray! Yeah!
Biggest thing of all, guys, discipline. All right, before and after whistles, discipline. This is the biggest area, guys, that cannot be compromised on.
Stay out of that shit after the whistle. We're gonna be a lot more disciplined than that, boys.
I think the thing that jumps out at me the most regarding his legacy is not the longevity of the number of games that he's won in the championships, but the fact that he's created a family of St. Lawrence hockey players up there. Those guys that played for him in the first decade, the guys that played him in his last decade, all think they played on the same team, and they all played for Coach Marsh.
I absolutely love it. It's a great place to play hockey. It's a great place to go if you want to feel part of a family, and that's why so many of my teammates are so loyal to the program. We loved playing for Joe. Joe made it fun. Joe made us want to come to the rink every day. He made us better people, he made us better hockey players.
Let's communicate in there. That's how you change it. You don't like the way it's going? Change it by talking and getting some composure. Let's use our poise, let's go now.
There's not many places you can go where it's 2,400 students and play Division I ice hockey. Ice hockey is St. Lawrence and St. Lawrence is ice hockey. And I think the coach, because he epitomized that, was able to convince young people that coming to a small school in way upstate New York, but playing really good Division I ice hockey, it was a real drawing card.
Many people will talk about challenges that St. Lawrence poses or the town of Canton poses. I mean, Joe always looked at those as opportunities, and that created a great positive atmosphere around the program.
I'm from here. I grew up watching St. Lawrence hockey. Obviously, to be able to come here and play is a dream come true, and Coach Marsh had a huge impact in my decision to come here. St. Lawrence University is directly tied to Joe Marsh and his name.
Joe Marsh's name is synonymous with many things, and winning is certainly one of them.
We play this game to win championships, and for me, I'm very proud of the fact that I was able to help Joe win one of his five championships. The year we won in 92 was the last year in Boston, so that was special.
Joe loved going back to Boston. Obviously, we wanted to perform, you know, not only for ourselves, but for Joe too. We're down 5-2 in the semifinals. Coach Carville and I at that time were line mates. There's 12 minutes to go in the game. We pretty much don't have a pulse. Carvey and I were actually having minor conversations about where we were headed going for spring break the next week. Boom, we score a goal, make it 5-3, so we stopped that conversation. We started thinking, hey, we might be able to get this thing going. We tie the game up with two power play goals. We win it in overtime.
Saved by Little Reba. They score! Chris Wells scores! Wells in double overtime, and St. Lawrence is in the championship game.
But Joe's on the ice and he tackles me and he's just so excited. Like, who scored? He didn't even know who scored. We knew after that game that we were going to win the next night. And he created that whole scenario. I mean, we're down 5-2. Carvey and I are talking about spring break. He's back there talking about, okay, we're going to get one. We're going to get one. So he kept the energy up. I've never lost that feeling. And this is a feeling and a memory I'll have for the rest of my life.
While most of Coach Marsh's life has been devoted to a game, there was one game that felt like it lasted a lifetime.
Well, first of all, it was a good college hockey game, obviously, but any time you play for 6 hours, that game started at 12 noon and finished at 6 o'clock at night.
St. Lawrence and Boston University played in the longest game in NCAA tournament history. It took four overtimes to decide the winner, and Coach Marsh left nothing to chance.
I remember being out in the hallway between overtime, seeing Joe down the other end with shooting the breeze, hit, should we flip a coin here and get out of here? It was getting a little dragged on.
Gillis couldn't come up. Loose puck. Deep field. They score! That's St. Quinnick. St. Lawrence going to Providence. The ninth most important appearance of date with Boston College.
This has been a great ride for sure. You talked about how tough it is to get here. There's no question. I thought it was pretty tough when we went 6 hours against BU on Sunday. A lot of people have talked about that game. It's a small school like ours to be on CNN Play of the Day the next day is probably akin for all you photographers getting a real good snapshot of the Loch Ness Monster. So I think that's we're pretty happy to be here.
His personality was as big as the program, and it drew a lot of kids here.
Joe's personality was a winning one. People would naturally see the sincerity of what he was trying to accomplish, the clarity in which he expressed himself. And of course, Joe did have a very good Irish sense of humor that never hurts.
How does a guy who's as big a damn screw-up as you were in college become coach at a major Division I program?
I dropped a few names. Yours was one of them.
What the f*** was that? What do you think, he had to put it down to Sergi's?
My funniest memory of Joe. Where do you start?
Are we taping this program?
If you got a memory with Joe, it's a funny one. Every time there's a microphone in front of him, you can be a funny guy.
It's tough to go on last. You know, you got to think of something clever to say. I mean, I've pretty much run out of clever things to say. I ran out of those in November. But
the smiling Irishman was always fun to be around, even though the players wouldn't necessarily agree with that.
I mean, you got to start with the temper tantrum. So that means kicking the garbage cans, throwing the stick over the glass, punching towel dispensers.
One day we were practicing and we were doing a drill, and he had to stop it once to tell us, hey, to stop it a second time. And he just lost it the third time. And he started screaming, and the spit was flying, swinging the stick, and his keys fell out of his pocket. And he went to shoot his keys, and he missed, and he went on his butt, and we're trying not to laugh. He gets up and helicopters his stick into the crowd, off the ice.
But the best part of all the temper tantrums was he would laugh at them, maybe not an hour or two later, but he would laugh a couple hours later.
Politically, I made the mistake once of telling him that I'm on the right side of the aisle and he's on the complete opposite, and he went on a rant about my party, if you will.
He was pretty direct and pretty upfront, and so when I got introduced to him, he said to me, oh, I remember you. You're the guy with the ugliest goalie mask in the entire world. Coach, I just want to let you know that you were right. It is the ugliest goalie mask in the world.
I first met Joe in 1978, and I was 16 years old, fresh off the prep school at New Hampton. He was our hockey coach, but he was also my math teacher. I guess he didn't like the attention that one of his students was giving him for his math course, so he went over to the student who was sitting at his desk and grabbed the kid, opened up the window, tosses him out the window. As this kid is falling out the window of the second floor into the snowbank, luckily, the headmaster of the school is going around giving a tour to prospective student and his family, and they see a student falling from the second floor, and I'm not sure if they enrolled in New Hampton or not, probably not, but Joe still got Teacher of the Year after that.
You know, the one thing that stands out, I think, in the hockey world is that we were down in Naples, Florida at the coaches convention.
We were in a real sunny room, and sliding glass doors were going out toward the beach, and you could hardly see it because the sun was bright.
I'm sitting next to Joe, and Joe wanted to, you know, get an extra muffin and coffee. He looks at me and goes, Welsie, you want me to get you another muffin, a wheel? You need a wheel or a coffee? I said, no, I'm good, Joe. So Joe takes off and he goes out the sliding glass door to where the outside buffet is.
Joe was walking out to the veranda. I was right behind him.
In the meantime, someone shut the sliding glass door. So Joe's got his muffin and a full hot coffee, and he realizes he's late, and he's going full bore. And he hit that sliding glass jar, just like the bird would.
He just walked right through the glass door, and everything was like bang and shattered and everything. And I remember Joe turning to me, saying, "Jerry, you don't have to. I'll open the door for you."
Joe, what I'm gonna miss most is our cup of coffee together in Naples. You were very, very, very good.
It was a good run. During his tenure at St. Lawrence, Joe Marsh coached 234 players and 44 captains. But there was truly only one captain, steering St. Lawrence hockey in a direction no one thought possible and leaving a legacy that will be hard to imitate.
Har, matey, I suppose you'll be thinking you're Captain Mirlosky. Har.
Remember Long John Silver? Yeah. That's what my brother told me the last time. I had a hair all to body hair. I had the chiclet missing. He says, you need a friggin' parrot. That's all you need. You get the look complete. I was hobbling around with a cane. You know, I had it going.
Going is never easy. Neither is what Coach Marsh did. Hockey in Canton is not just a game. It is a way of life. It is passed down through generations, taught by older brothers, and talked about by neighbors. Perhaps that's why Joe Marsh isn't going anywhere. He will be part of St. Lawrence University forever.